feelings about others, specifically National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster. Here was Sarah Sanders just a moment ago.
You said that this is something that the media wants to talk about right now, but frankly, it's the president who's repeatedly sort of stoked the speculation. Just yesterday, he said, I think you want to see change. Earlier this week, he said, I'm really at a point where we're getting very close to having the cabinet and other things that I want. So isn't it the president himself who's sort of creating this aura of, some use the word chaos, but simply put, turmoil or a potential upheaval within the West Wing and frankly, across the administration?
Taking two sentences out of the thousands of remarks that the president makes and trying to make it look like that's the entire focus of his administration
I'm at a point where we're getting close to having the cabinet and other things I want. There will always be change. I think you want to see change.
Yeah, and he just nominated two new people to be part of his cabinet. So we are getting close. We'd like those two individuals to be quickly confirmed, quickly put through that process so that they can take a seat at the table, so that they can continue to engage with the president on big issues that actually matter to the American people.
Let's go to the White House to a reporter there, Caitlin Collins. And it seemed to me, listening to Sarah, it was almost like, all right, no immediate personnel changes, nothing to see here, you know, move along.
Yeah, that's right, Brooke. She said not immediate, but she did not say that there would be no imminent changes here. And this is just simply not what actually happened here this week at the White House. It was actually very likely that the president was looking to fire McMaster. But now, with all these reports, they've kind of tried to tamp down those concerns. And Sarah Sanders said there that she spoke with President Trump last night and that he said McMaster's job is safe for now, and that she was the one who passed that message along to McMaster, which interestingly enough, the president himself didn't tell McMaster that his job was safe, despite all of these reports. But Peter Alexander of NBC News there is correct. This is the president who has contributed to a lot of the reports that there is going to be this big staff shakeup here, Brooke, because it's the president who openly questions and polls his friends and allies and advisors on who they think could be a good replacement for several positions here at the White House, including the chief of staff's job, and including the National Security Advisor's job. And we also know that he met with John Bolton just here in the Oval Office less than 2 weeks ago, and that is someone that has been a favored contender for that position. So the president has a lot to do with this here, Brooke. So though they're saying it's the media who's reporting on these staff shakeups, it's because the president is the one polling several people. Now, another thing she said there is that the president and McMaster have a great working relationship. She said that they had several meetings together today, but based on CNN reporting, the president and McMaster actually have not gotten along during their time here together in the administration. And the president actually chafes at the way that McMaster briefs him because he feels that he's condescending when he speaks to him and when he's briefing him on a daily basis on those things happening around the world. And instead, he prefers someone like the defense secretary, James Mattis. But overall, Brooke, our reporting today has showed that actually the president has been enjoying watching the media report on these shakeup. He kind of sits back and delights in the conflict. And a lot of that conflict here, Brooke, comes from the top, comes from the man at the top himself.
What about, quickly, Stormy Daniels? You know, the headline today from Stormy Daniels' attorney that she was physically threatened to stay silent, to sign that NDA. I mean, just listening to Sarah a second ago, she was basically just saying, I can't say much about it, and I refer you to outside counsel. Is that all we've got?
Yeah. It's a very familiar tactic from this White House. They do not elaborate when they come to these questions. And it's not a surprise that Sarah Sanders did that there, because we know when she said the other week that the president had won arbitration against Stormy Daniels, it actually created a lot of problems in this White House, because the first time that the White House acknowledged any kind of relationship between the president and this woman. So it's not surprising that she instead today wasn't going to answer, wasn't going to go anywhere further on those, instead referring reporters to the president's outside lawyers here. But this is continuing to be a story for this White House, as you see here, Brooke. It's still being brought up many weeks after it was first brought up. And now that Stormy Daniels has done an interview with 60 Minutes, it's not likely that these questions are going to go away anytime soon at this briefing. And one thing I should note is Sarah Sanders did say there that she has not spoken with the president about these claims from Stormy Daniels' lawyers, which is much different than what we heard from her just last week when she said that she had spoken to the president about these questions from the press on Stormy Daniels. So it seems that they're not bringing that up even with the president himself anymore before she comes out here to brief her. reporters.
Yep, yep. Caitlin, thank you so much. Let's talk more about the headlines that Caitlin just perfectly laid out. Gloria Borger's with me, our CNN chief political analyst. And Gloria, I mean, I just wanted to start with this whole H.R. McMaster bit because you were the one last night reporting all this material out. And now you have Sarah Sanders a second ago saying that, you know, she talked to the president last night, that he asked me to pass along, you know, that McMaster's job is safe, and that she said that Trump is actually was in a meeting today with McMaster. What was your reaction to hearing that?
Well, you know, it wasn't just me, Brooke. It was me and my colleagues and people at other news organizations. We're all hearing the same things. And I think that, you know, she had to go into the president. He put the kibosh on it because he is the decider and he can say, for whatever reason, okay, I'm not going to do that now. And maybe it's because he doesn't have a replacement. We were told it's also because McMaster doesn't have a place to land and they don't want to duplicate the sort of Tillerson fiasco in the way that he was fired. But look, everything is up to the president. So every story is as hard as jello until the president decides. And that is the way it is. And so we can report, and Caitlin's absolutely right. We live in this kind of echo chamber where we talk to people inside the White House, people who were recently of the White House but no longer, people who talk to the president, who are friends of his, and he tends himself to muse aloud about, boy, I'd really like to get rid of that one, or who do you think could come in and be my new chief of staff? And on and on.
And he's enjoying, but he's enjoying this. According to our sources, he's sitting there, like, you know,
listening to it,
watching it all.
I spoke to a source who said, look, the president's on cloud nine, is the way he put it. He likes this. People are paying attention to him, and he looks like he's the man in charge. He thinks. I think what perhaps Kelly may be saying to him is, you know, we need to kind of let this settle a little bit. Although we're also told that the president chafes when Kelly tells him he can't do things. Although maybe they've settled that for now. We just don't know.
We don't. Gloria, thank you.
Sure.
I have a really interesting voice I want to bring in. Barbara Rez, a former executive vice president at the Trump Organization, who was first hired by Donald Trump to build Trump Tower. She wrote the book All Alone on the 68th Floor, How One Woman Changed the Face of Construction. So it is a pleasure to have you back. Thank you so much for swinging back through CNN. And first, I just want to ask you, you chuckled a little when you heard Gloria mention every story is as hard as jello.
That was a funny line.
It was a funny line. And when you listen to all this reporting about Trump sitting back and enjoying watching all the conflict play out and all his different TV screens, does that sound like the Donald Trump you worked
for? Yes, absolutely. Yes, he loved conflict. He liked to pit people against each other.
Why? Help us understand that.
Well, you know, from back in my time, I think the main reason for it was because it was a divide and conquer kind of thing. If people were fighting with each other, they were not getting together to oppose him on some of the crazy things he was doing. And he liked that. He also liked the fact that he wanted to see who would survive, you know, survival of the fittest. And he had some very, very strong people. I can think of two women that were both in residential sales, and he had them at each other's back. And he loved it. He loved watching it.
Why does he feel like that's good for business, a.k.a. why would that be good, translating it to the White House, good for the country?
It certainly wasn't good for business, and it's not good for the country. And I can't imagine why he feels that. I think that he puts his entertainment ahead of his logic, if he has any.
But you knew him. I mean, how many years going back? This is way pre-apprentice Donald Trump. As a businessman, you were brought in to help build Trump Tower. You know, I remember the line he asked you if you liked candy.
That was a lot later.
That was a lot later. Yeah. Not the nicest thing to say to a woman. But you've also said he's the most, non-sexist man you'd ever worked for?
I said, and I was misquoted, and
Let's set the record straight. What was he like?
What I said was, in terms of the way he treated me as a person in his employ, compared to the way he treated the men, there was no difference. So in that, he was the least sexist boss. Everyone I had always deferred to me. Donald did not defer to me. He didn't give me, put me on a pedestal or anything else. He didn't give me any particular respect. He put me down like, well, he cursed me out like he did the other men. And he also took, back then when he listened to people, he listened to me and he took my advice on things. So he really treated me like he treated the men.
When you say back then listened to people, are you inferring that he's not listening to people anymore?
I'm absolutely saying that, yes. I don't see him listening to people. And you can see that, you know, somebody will go out and say one thing and 2 hours later, Trump has said something completely opposite to it.
Are you following this whole Stormy Daniels saga? I mean, what do you
How
make
can you
of,
not?
What do you make of it?
Well, you know, Trump, and in my time with him and in my experience with him and watching, he loves intimidation. I mean, while I was working for him, I saw him intimidate contractors by taking a picture of Roy Cohn out of his desk drawer and waving it and saying, he's going to sue you, he's going to sue you. He loved to intimidate and scare people. And after I left and I came out against him, I was threatened by his dog, Michael Cohen, for some kind of a slander case. And I was threatened by his secretary, Rona Grapp, that she was going to release emails that I sent as if I cared.
When you say threatened, what kind of threat?
A threat like, you know, this is a pending lawsuit or I'm going to embarrass you, you know, that kind of thing.
But was it ever, because the news today on Stormy Daniels is the fact that this attorney is saying that she felt that she was threatened with physical violence if she talked. Did you ever experience or ever hear of any of that sort of threat?
Coming from Donald, no, not directly, but certainly illegal acts of that kind of thing I've seen occur with people that worked for him doing things that were not, you know, necessarily legal. And, you know, I was just reading, I was taking a book this morning, and I remember him asking somebody that was very important to him in the security, would he kill for him? And the man saying, yes, Mr. Trump. And Mr. Trump said again, would you kill for me? And he said yes. So, I mean, you know, there's nothing off the plate here as far as I'm concerned. Anything is possible.
What do you think of the news just in the last 24 hours that we've learned that the special counsel, Bob Mueller, is now officially looking into the Trump organization, wants to subpoena these documents? I mean, that's how far he's gone. Are you surprised?
Not at all surprised, no. I think that, you know, enough information has come out that inter-office communications, emails, that kind of thing have been used. And I think that Mueller has every right to see what was going on inside the organization.
When you watch the president on TV, do you recognize the man as the man you used to work for? I mean, how much has he changed from back in the day with you to now leading the country?
I definitely recognize his demeanor, the way that he carries himself, his ego. What is different for me, and this sort of came out during the campaign, was this abject sexism. I had not seen that firsthand. I had seen a womanizer. I had seen, you know, someone that sort of valued women by their appearances. I never saw anything like what we saw in Access Hollywood. And now with the Stormy Daniels and all the other stuff coming out, that was a little bit surprising to me.
Last question. Do you think he loves being in the White House, or do you think deep down he's in over his head and he knows it?
He is over his head. He doesn't know it, and he probably does love it, yeah.
Barbara Ress, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Appreciate it. Coming up here, more on this Stormy Daniels scandal. My next guest suggests President Trump could be more worried about the financial impact of this story, not the political impact. We'll discuss that. Also, a stunning new security breach. The Department of Homeland Security says Russian hackers have gained access to American nuclear, electric.
I've been approached by six separate women who claim to have similar stories to those or to that of my client. Two of those women, at least two, have NDAs. We are in the very early stages of vetting those stories. I want to preach caution and...
Starting with all things Stormy, Rick, you tweeted that Trump is worried about this whole Stormy scandal because of financial reasons and not political. Why?
I think he feels like his political base is secure. They've told us over and over they will tolerate any amorality, any scuzzy behavior. I mean, he could be hitting it with her on the White House lawn and they'd be like, yay, go MAGA. But I do think he is worried now that as the NDAs start to look a little more brittle, and as Stormy Daniels and other folks look at angles by which they could litigate on this, I think he knows it's going to cost him legally. It's going to cost him financially. It's going to start eating up his bandwidth. He's going to have to actually pay lawyers. They're not all going to take out a home equity loan to cover up his dalliances with porn stars. So he's going to end up with a lot of costs. And I think also, you know, we got to also think about Melania's prenup with him. So there may be a money equation there as well that he puts him at some risk.
Why, if the president, I mean, obviously he is involved, two Trump attorneys connected to keeping Stormy quiet here. If the president is innocent, why not say so publicly?
Well, I don't think that the president wants to dignify this story, be it true or false, because it's something that is personal and has nothing to do with him as the president of the United States of America. It didn't happen, if the allegations are true, while he was a candidate for president. It didn't happen while he was sitting in the Oval Office. This is something that is just terribly embarrassing for the First Lady. That's what I think about every time I hear these stories. I'm sure
that... But it happened, Paris. Let me just jump in, because mm-hmm. It happened days before the election, and the president, on his Twitter feed, does seem to weigh in on everything else.
Sure. I think the payment from Michael Cohen, from his personal account, from a line of credit, whatever, from his home to Stormy Daniels did happen before the election. But the alleged affair.
You don't think that's a big deal, the timing?
OK, I feel you struggling here. Let me help you out here.
No, I can't.
Donald
I'm not
Trump
struggling.
Has a long,
pattern
pattern of engagement with a variety of women to whom he is not married. Michael Cohen has long been out there doing these NDAs for these various women that Trump was involved with sexually and in other capacities. This is something that is a long pattern of behavior. Now, are you telling me that Republicans have never once brought up the fact that Bill Clinton screwed his way through Arkansas? No. They did it all the time. It wasn't because it was before he was president that makes a difference. It's that he did it at all. And the fact that Donald Trump has an attorney.
Let me interrupt you. No, it's different because at the time, Bill Clinton was the attorney general and he was a sitting governor of Arkansas. And the claims came by someone who was a sitting elected official. Donald Trump, these allegations took place before.
Let Paris finish.
These allegations took place before he was president and before he was a candidate. He was not a public official, and there's a different standard. It's totally different. So you're comparing apples and oranges. If, however, something happened to President Trump while he was in the Oval Office, then that would be something different. But that's not what happened like what happened with President Clinton.
If your standard is that low and you're okay with him screwing porn stars, if you're okay with him screwing porn stars, just say the words. I'm okay with Donald Trump screwing porn stars. Can you say that for me, Paris? Because
you know what I will say is that you have no respect for Mrs. Trump. You have no respect for his children. You have no respect for his family.
I'm sorry.
Because this has nothing to do
Paris.
With him as
I'm
a
sorry.
Candidate, and it has nothing
Let's
to do
see.
With him as the
Let's
sitting
see.
President of the United
Trump?
States. You can dig up dirty laundry, and
hey,
I pray
Paris,
to God
perhaps
nobody goes back in your
respect.
Past and picks up
perhaps
something that has nothing to do
respect,
with your
Paris.
Present time
perhaps
as sitting here on this commentator.
We're going to talk
but
about
it's rude and it's offensive. It has nothing to do with him as a president. Criticize the president for
his policy.
But don't go back and criticize him for something that has nothing to do with the presidency.
For folks across this country because of his behavior towards people. Don't you dare talk about respect when he insulted the family of Humayun Khan. Don't you dare talk about respect when Donald Trump insulted John McCain's war service. That is a man who has no respect for anyone on this earth. And the fact that you're defending him on that speaks much more about your character and the low
Rick,
standards
I don't know you
have.
Rick, I don't know you, but I would advise you to not question my character because you don't know me. But if you like to talk to me about my character and what I believe, I can have that conversation separately. But what I will say is
Step
if you're
up,
going
bro.
To impugn the integrity of the
you're
president,
defending
do
Trump
so on things that are relevant to him
it's
as
okay.
a candidate
okay.
and
Embrace
as the president. Not things
just
that have nothing
say,
to do with his
I love
presidency.
That Donald Trump's
That's all
porn
I'm
star.
Saying.
You can
Continue
just say
to rabble.
You can just say
Guys,
it.
No personal insults. No personal insults, please. And let me jump in because Paris, here's a question for you. Is we are talking about the payment coming out just days before the presidential election. Let me flip it around. If this was Hillary Clinton, what would happen if Hillary Clinton's lawyer paid off an accuser days before the election? How do you think Trump would react? Fair question.
I think on the issue of a payment by the lawyer, I think he would have a reaction. Absolutely.
And what kind of reaction do you think that would be?
It would be negative. I'm certain it would be negative. But I'm also saying that that is a separate issue from if she did something while she was a candidate or if she did something while she was the sitting Secretary of State. That is what I'm, all I'm saying is, let's separate apples from oranges. If we're going to talk about the payment and the timing of that, that's fair. But to bring up this, the allegation that happened long before he was a candidate or president,
but
I think
connected.
It's irrelevant. And
listen,
I think that's why
he's
not
commenting.
I hear
you loud and clear, because this happened. It happened years and years ago, and I think you're absolutely right in pointing out he was private citizen Donald Trump at the time. But it is entirely germane, because we're talking about the payment and the hush, this hush money days before everyone went to the polls to elect him as president of the United States. That is, you are allowed to connect the two there.
You're allowed to raise the question as to why Michael Cohen did that in his personal capacity as his lawyer. But at the end of the day, there's attorney-client privilege, and that's not going to come out. And I think all of this extra comment about what Stormy has to say or what she doesn't have to say is just to embarrass the First Lady, because her commentary has nothing to do with the presidency. Let's have a conversation and let the lawyers figure out if there is something untoward about the payment. Did it come from the Trump Organization? Did it come from President Trump? Michael Cohen says it didn't. Michael Cohen said he took it out of his own line of credit from his mortgage to pay for, because he is someone who supports the president and didn't want this getting out. That's on Michael Cohen, not on the president.
Go ahead, Rick. I know you want to jump in. Go ahead.
You know, the argument that Donald Trump's lifelong pattern of infidelity, adultery, shattering every vow of every one of his marriages by his own admission, and the fact that Donald Trump screwed a porn star. Now, I don't think Melania Trump's going to be more embarrassed by what Michael Cohen or Stormy Daniels has to say than by the fact that a few months after she had a kid, her husband was screwing a porn star. And that's what you're saying is okay. I get it. You accept that. That's part of your moral framework. That's part of your moral landscape. Good for
Rick,
you.
You
go
know what?
Do.
Bro, I'm not going to tolerate that.
Paris,
you don't know my moral framework.
You don't tell me what you're going to tolerate.
No, I am going to tell you what
right
you're not going to do. When it comes to me,
part of your moral
you're not going
to
do it, Rick.
It's okay
Rick,
for
I'm
Donald Trump
here.
To screw a porn star. It's okay for Donald Trump to screw a porn star if he's just not the president.
Keep saying it
okay?
more and more. Keep saying it more and more. Get it out. Get it out of your system. We
is
all
that
know
what
that's
saying?
What you
right.
want to say. But at the end of the day,
Paris,
he's still the president, and you should have a little bit more respect for Mrs. Trump than to continue to talk about this. Have a decent conversation about the payment and Michael Cohen. Go ahead and do that. This has nothing to do with his candidacy. It has nothing to do with the presidency. Let's have a conversation
Trump,
on policy.
Her husband shouldn't have screwed okay. a porn star.
Okay. Paris and Rick. Wow.
Threatening any individual, but I have no knowledge of that situation and would refer you to the president's outside personal attorneys.
That is how the White House responded just a little bit ago from these new claims from Stormy Daniels' lawyer that she had been physically threatened to stay silent. So let me bring in Paul Ryan. Paul Ryan, who is the watchdog group Common Cause with them. Paul, thank you so much for being with me. And we wanted to talk to you because it's your group who's already filed that federal complaint over the payment made by Trump. We were just discussing this, right, days before via Michael Cohen to silence Stormy Daniels. The two headlines today, let me just begin with these allegations that Daniels was physically threatened to stay silent. What do you make of the allegation, and how does that at all factor into your case?
You know, the allegation is not surprising at all, and it's very, very troubling. Depending on the jurisdiction in which those threats occurred, it could rise to the level of assault or some other criminal charge. So that's bad news for Team Trump. But the bottom line, the reason Common Cause is interested in this is because Americans have a right to know who's spending money right before an election to influence voters when they're going into the voting booths. Here we have $130,000 expenditure by Team Trump to influence voters when undisclosed, and that's not even the biggest violation. Common Cause last week filed a complaint about a Team Trump violation to the tune of $40 million and growing that's underway. No one's talking about that. American First priorities, or American First policies, rather, is the name of this dark money C4 group that's up and running, raising and spending dark money in the election. So there are a lot of problems with Team Trump and hiding information from voters right now.
The other issue, just staying on this Stormy Daniels story, is that this lawyer who was on says that there are six more women, this is according to him, six women who want to come forward. They say they have very similar stories to Stormy Daniels, two of whom he says actually were forced into or did sign NDAs. He's vetting all these people. But what does that tell you as it relates to your efforts?
The really interesting comment that he also made was that at least two of them, to his knowledge, have signed non-disclosure agreements. If there was a payment involved there, we're going to be looking to file more complaints. And these two new potential emerging complaints for payments to influence the election by Team Trump that went undisclosed may have violated contribution limits. They're not the only ones. Last month, we filed a complaint against AMI, the tabloid company that paid Karen McDougal $150,000 for her silence in direct coordination with Michael Cohen. Another very similar violation of what's at stake or what's at issue in the Stormy Daniels matter.
Okay. Paul Ryan, thank you so much. We'll stay in close contact and see what happens with what you filed. Appreciate it. Coming up next here, Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke makes a tone-deaf comment to a congresswoman as she is discussing this program to honor survivors of Japanese internment camps. We will play Zinke about her grandfather's detention in an internment camp for Japanese Americans during World War II. She wanted to make sure money would be set aside to preserve the historic sites, and this is how Secretary Zinke responded.
I believe that it is essential that we as a nation recognize our darkest moments so that we don't have them repeat again. So, Mr. Secretary, I'd like to know, even with the president zeroing it out, are you committed to continue the grant programs that are identified, I believe, as the Japanese American Confinement Sites Grants Program, which were funded in 2017? Will we see it funded again in 2018?
Oh, konnichiwa.
I think it's still Ohayou gozaimasu, but that's okay.
I guess it's adjutant.
There was a woman, you couldn't see it, but her jaws just went, what? Congresswoman Hanabusa corrected Zinke's greeting for good morning. He had given the traditional Japanese greeting for good afternoon. Nevertheless, some lawmakers, Japanese Americans, viewed the timing of the comments as incredibly insensitive. So let's chat this over with David Sanger and other issues. David Sanger is our CNN political and national security analyst and a national security correspondent for the New York Times. I mean, I've watched that clip over a couple of times now, and it's like, file this under, what was he thinking?
Yeah, it is sort of hard to figure out, Brooke. I spent 6 years in Japan as a Times correspondent, and had he been in Japan and in a Japanese context, maybe it would have made sense, because he would have shown that he was, you know, trying to speak the language. But he's talking to Americans here, and the fact that they're Japanese Americans is probably less central to this conversation than they are Americans, and raising a very critical question, which is, what is the commitment to building some memorials to what was one of the darkest moments, I think most people would agree, in American civil liberties history, the decision to go confine and intern actual American citizens. And so it did seem to me that it was a flip at best and maybe a little tone deaf at very worst. Yeah.
Let's move to your reporting in the Times about these cyber attacks plotted by Russians on the U.S. power grid and nuclear and water facilities, how they could have sabotaged or shut power plants off at will. Reading your piece, I mean, how serious is this threat?
Well, it's a pretty serious threat, but what's really interesting here, Brooke, is if you back off and look at the timing. So the first intrusions into the American power plants here of this particular attack, there have obviously been other Russian attacks, was at the end of 2015. What else was going on at that time? Other Russian groups were going into the Democratic National Committee. So we had different, probably uncoordinated attacks underway simultaneously. Second, this was an effort to go put these implants into American power systems and to do them in a way that the Russians would have access to basically the control panels of those systems remotely. Now, they didn't do what they did in Ukraine. In Ukraine in 2015, around the same time, they turned off the lights. Here, it wasn't used, and there are some experts I've spoken to who think that, in fact, the Russians wanted to be discovered. Because what they wanted to do was send a message that if we ever got into a serious conflict with them, they're already inside our system and could flip the switch at will.
They're big on sending a message, aren't they? With the nerve agent in England, we know the only place that could have made that, and in this case as well. What about North Korea? We know, of course, the news this week. Tillerson's out. You have an outgoing Secretary of State. You still don't have a South Korean ambassador, no North Korean special envoy, and it is Ivanka Trump, David, who is meeting with the South Korean envoy. This is happening just a month or so-ish. We're hearing now end of May for this potential Kim Jong-un-Trump meeting. How is the U.S. possibly ready for this meeting of two men?
I can't imagine that we are, because Secretary of State Tillerson thought until last Sunday that he was conducting this negotiation himself. He was the one who was out putting the lines out, as he used to put it, to the North Koreans in an effort to work toward a diplomatic solution. And 3 days after it looks like that is beginning to be set up, he gets fired. So Mike Pompeo, the designee for Secretary of State, is not likely to be confirmed for another month, month and a half, probably. If he gets confirmed, we assume that he will. As you say, there's no ambassador to South Korea. There's no North Korea special envoy in the State Department. And this kind of meeting takes a lot of preparation, unless the president believes that he is so confident in his own negotiating skills that he can just sort of go in there and wing it with Kim Jong-un and try to set an agreement in principle and then leave it to others to sort out the details later on. My guess is, given the history of North Korea negotiations, that's probably a prescription for something going wrong along the way.
Mm-hmm. Let's hope we never have to say the sentence, winging it in Kim Jong-un, in the same breath ever again. David Singer, thank you so, so very much. We'll see if this, you know, when this happens, according to the White House. Good to see you. Thank you.
Thank you.